and a given flit has to go across, there are various resources that have to be acquired. Okay, so the first thing that I have to acquire is a free virtual channel, right? So if I look at the head flit, and then you have the body flits behind it until you see a tail flit, right? So, you know, this guy might have arrived on some input port, okay, and he wants to go on the north port. And at the end of this link is, let's say, three different virtual channels, okay? And, you know, let's say that there are three different packets that are currently in transit over here, right? So there is a body flit that is over here, and over here. And so three different packets are kind of, you know, being interleaved and are going across this link. Eventually, you know, one of them is going to send off its tail flit. So at this point, you know that, you know, virtual channel, so this is, let's say, virtual channel 0, 1, and 2. So now you know that virtual channel 2 is free. Okay, so this packet that is trying to go across, you know, demands the arbiter that it be granted a virtual channel. Once the tail flit is sent, you know that, you know, that one packet has finished this transmission. So virtual channel 2 is now ready to receive a new packet. Okay, so the arbiter maybe grants it to this packet. So then the head flit goes along and puts itself into this virtual channel 2, right? So, and there's some state being kept over here saying that this packet has been assigned to virtual channel 2. So now when these body flits go across, they also carry that same ID. Okay, so before a packet can hop from one router to the next, the first thing you have to do is acquire a virtual channel ID. Once that is done, you know, that same virtual channel ID is used for all of your body and tail flits. Finally, when the tail flit goes through, it releases that virtual channel ID to be used by somebody else. The next resource that you need to acquire is make sure that there is a free buffer entry in your virtual channel at the next router, right? So if the body flit has been assigned to virtual channel 2, it has to make sure that there is something free over here before it can make the hop across, right? So that's the next thing you need to acquire. The third thing you need to acquire is the link itself, right? Because I said that there are multiple different packets in transit at the same time. In this case, there are three different packets that are all sharing the same physical link. So again, there has to be an arbiter that grants the physical channel to one of these three packets every single cycle. Okay, so a flit goes across, assuming it has an assigned virtual channel, assuming there's a free buffer entry in that virtual channel at the receiving router, and assuming that there is a free cycle on the physical channel. Right? So once it acquires these three resources, the flit then goes across. The head flit has to worry about acquiring the virtual channel ID. The body flits have already been assigned a virtual channel ID, and they're essentially competing for a free buffer entry and a cycle on the physical channel. Okay, so this kind of explains the process of a packet basically, you know, moving from one router to the next. So, you know, as I said, there are three different resources that have to be acquired. You have to acquire a virtual channel. I just explained how that virtual channel is assigned. You also have to acquire the physical channel, the physical link, and I just said that there's an arbiter that grants the physical link to, you know, one of the three packets every single cycle. The third thing is the free buffer entry. So how do you figure out if there's a free buffer entry at the other end? And there are multiple strategies to do this. So you can either use a credit-based mechanism or you can use an on-off mechanism. A credit-based mechanism helps every single router keep track of the buffer entries that are free over here every single cycle, right? So at startup, you know that all the buffer entries are free. Every time you send a message over here, you know that available buffers has to be decremented, okay? And every time something from here gets sent somewhere else, you have to send a message back saying that I just freed up one of your buffer entries, so you can now do, you know, buffer entries plus plus, right? So this is called the credit-based scheme, where every time somebody goes, say, downstream, you have to send a message upstream to let the previous router know that the buffer entry is now free. Okay, an alternative way that minimizes all of this traffic is to use on-off signaling, which says that, you know, once my buffer entries get close to being full, I'm going to send a message back saying, you know, my buffers are almost full, please stop sending me any more messages. And then, you know, once these start to go away, and once this goes down to a lower level, then you send another message saying that now, you know, I have enough free entries that I'm willing to receive more messages. Okay, so there are different ways to keep track of how many free buffer entries there are in all of your neighboring routers. I should also mention that, you know, virtual channels are a very effective way to also avoid deadlocks. Okay, so, you know, let's say that I'm trying to do adaptive routing, okay, and I want to allow myself to make all four possible turns. You know, that can lead to a deadlock. But now note that a link terminates in, you know, one of three possible sets of buffers. And I can number each of these sets of buffers, right? So for example, I can call this buffer number 1. I can call this buffer number 101, and this one is buffer number 201. Okay, so when I'm making a jump from one link to the next, I have an option of picking which resource I'm going to place this data in. And because I'm giving myself a wide range of numbers, it's perhaps possible for me to pick a higher numbered resource on every single jump, right? And I'd mentioned earlier that as you go from A to B, if you're always acquiring resources that are higher numbered, then it's impossible to construct a cycle of dependencies. Okay, so you know, let's say I'm going from A to B down over here. So initially I say that I'm going to try to use these small numbered virtual channels. Okay, so when I make a jump from here to here, this one is link number 1, which terminates in buffers 1, 101, and 201. So first I acquire, you know, buffer number 1. That's the virtual channel that I first use. Okay, then if I were to use dimension order routing, I would go straight over here. But, you know, because there's congestion over there, I say, you know, let me instead go down. Okay, so this is link number 17, which terminates in virtual channels 17, 117, and 217. It's safe for me to use number 17 because that's an increasing numbered resource. So that's the virtual channel I'll use over here. Then I decide that there is too much congestion, you know, to go downwards. So let me make another turn and head towards the east. So I go on this link, which is numbered 2 over here. Okay, and so this link number 2 ends in virtual channels numbered 2, 102, and 202. Using virtual channel number 2 would not be an option because then I'm using a lower numbered resource. So I now have to jump to the next plane. So now instead I use virtual channel number 102. Okay, and then I should continue going towards the east, but let's say there's congestion over there. So I go downwards. This is, you know, link number 18, ending in virtual channels 18, 118, 218. The only options are 118 and 218. Let me pick 118. Okay, and then I decide again to go to the right. Okay, instead of going down, I decide to make a turn towards the east. And this is link number 3, ending in virtual channels 3, 103, and 203. I can't even use 103 because that's lower than 118. So I have to jump to the next plane. I have to use 203. And now there are no more higher planes. I'm assuming a case where there are only 3 virtual channels on every single link. Okay, so now I don't have an escape route in case I get into trouble, right? So from this point onwards, I have to pick a routing algorithm that is known to be deadlock free, right? So from here onwards, I need to go to B while only using something like dimension ordered routing. Okay, so you know, with virtual channels, I can kind of I can do adaptive routing for a while, and then I'll ultimately get to a point where I can no longer do adaptive routing. From that point on, I have to use some kind of deterministic routing algorithm. Okay, so with virtual channels, you can also use it as a tool to avoid deadlocks. So there are many uses of using virtual channels. It improves performance, and it also helps you avoid deadlocks.